Hi, it's Steve. This is day 7 of my 30 days of video series, and also day 7 of my water fast. So I've gone almost a week now with no food. It's a little after 6 p.m. So I'll give you a quick update on the fast first. It's going pretty well so far, about as I expected. My energy is a bit low right now. Today was pretty sluggish. Most of this week it's been a bit on the low energy side, a bit sluggish. I think I got about, 2-3 hours work done today, which is pretty typical for how this fast has been going so far. I spent most of the day lying on the couch, honestly, just not having much energy for anything. I'm missing food a lot today. I keep thinking about all the different kinds of foods I want to eat. I'm not really hungry though. Like, the hunger is past several days ago, so that's not an issue. But there's a physical aspect to eating, the hunger and the satiety and feeling full inside. And there's also a psychological aspect, just the comfort and the grounding of eating meals. I've skipped, about 20 meals so far. So I'm really, missing that experience of eating and not having food in my body. Especially miss Rochelle's cooking. She's a much better cook than I am. I'm not bad as a cook, but she's way better than I am. And especially, I keep thinking about this one dish she makes. She makes it a lot because we both really love it. It's really good. It's udon noodles with steamed vegetables like broccolini, baby bok choy, and zucchini, and spinach, and sometimes some kale, and then with a peanut ginger garlic sauce that's so good, and some sesame seeds sprinkled on top. And I often eat it with sriracha because I love spicy food too. And it's so good, and I just keep thinking, oh, I'd love a bowl of that right now. I tell myself, just take it one day at a time. When I think of doing this for 30 days, if I make it that long, and I'm only on day 7, it seems really daunting. Like, oh man, I gotta go to another 3 weeks with no food. And it won't be till, sometime in May that I get to eat again. That kind of gets me down a bit. But if I just think, just make it through today, you can always cheat tomorrow, you can always quit early tomorrow. I tell myself that, playing these mental games with myself, knowing that I'll probably keep going. And that worked well for me last year when I did the 17-day water fast, just taking it one day at a time, sometimes on the toughest days, 1 hour at a time. It's going well. Otherwise, I'm just getting used to the lower physical energy. And, I'm thinking especially about Thai food. I love Thai food, so I keep thinking of all these Thai food dishes I'd love to have. But instead, I'm about to have dinner, and this is my dinner. A nice glass of water. So that can get me down a bit emotionally because I miss the experience of eating, but you just take it one day at a time and you get through it. And especially I remind myself, this is a temporary experience and it's for personal growth reasons, and I'll probably get a lot of benefits out of this. So I keep reminding myself of that. I wouldn't say it's a terrible struggle, though. It's definitely something I can handle. It's just a matter of getting used to it. I think, having last year's experience of going through the 17-day fast, that really helped a lot. Going into this one, knowing what to expect. It was much harder the first 3 days of that previous year's fast than this one was. And I think a big part of that was just knowing what to expect. So the main topic I wanted to talk about in this video is the lifestyle consequences of your decisions. So when you make certain decisions in life, what we often don't realize is that you're going to have some lifestyle consequences based on those decisions. For instance, suppose you get a job and you work for a company. Well, that may require you to go to a certain place every day, like the building where the company is. If you have to commute each day, that's going to be part of your lifestyle. You may have to get up a certain time each morning, go to bed a certain time to be able to have the energy for your work day. you may be tied to a certain, cubicle or office or something like that. You may have your schedule dictated largely by somebody else. You may have somebody else determine what kinds of projects you have to work on, what assignments you get. Your income may be largely determined by someone else, and that can greatly affect your lifestyle, especially the freedom you have. I remember back in 2005 when I started this polyphasic sleep experiment, which is a crazy experiment that requires sleeping only 20 minutes at a time every 4 hours around the clock. And it's really terrible sleep deprivation the first week to 10 days. And not everyone can adapt to it. But I did that for 5.5 months. It was just a crazy wild experiment. And I, to this day, I still get emails from people about this experience. In fact, I did an interview in London last year with a reporter about this experience, and I haven't even done it for more than 10 years. But at the time that I was doing it, and even for many years afterwards, it's one of the most emailed things that people message me about. The question people would ask me often is, you know, I have a job and I would love to do this experiment, and how can I do it? And I would tell them, I really don't think you can. If you have to be at a certain place at a certain time and you can't take the naps on a regular schedule, they were trying to find a way to, you know, stretch this nap schedule and make it fit a schedule dictated by somebody else. And I told them, I just don't see that happening. You need a lot of flexibility to be able to do that kind of experiment. So that's just one of many examples of something you might not be able to do if you make a decision that restricts your lifestyle in some way. Now, it's not necessarily the case you have to make a decision that gives you unlimited lifestyle freedom. You can make decisions that restrict or constrain your lifestyle. A lot of different kinds of decisions do that. Whenever I book a workshop, for instance, I know that I'm going to have to be in a certain place at a certain time, and I'll have to spend some time preparing for the workshop, and I'll have to go into full-on extrovert mode during those 3 days to connect with the people there. It's a high-energy experience. It's really draining. And in fact, the very first workshop I did in 2009, the night after the workshop was done, I slept 14 hours straight without waking up because I was just so exhausted from the experience. It really gets my energy up. It was really exciting, but it was, you know, big downswing afterwards. And if I'm not careful, I can get sick after these events too if I'm not sleeping enough and getting enough rest. But in terms of the, you know, lifestyle consequences, I've enjoyed a very free lifestyle the past many years, more than a decade now, ever since I was blogging. And a large part of that was very deliberate. And I learned that, you know, certain decisions make my lifestyle easier and more fun and more open and more free, and other decisions restrict and constrain me. And I became, over time, especially after well over 20 years as an entrepreneur, very sensitive to the types of decisions I would make and how they might impact my schedule. One thing I love is having a fairly blank calendar, not having a lot of appointments. So when people say they want to do a meetup or something like that, and they're emailing me months before they're coming to Vegas, I tell them, I'm not even going to put it on my calendar. Just email me a couple days before you get here, and I'll see if I'm in town, because I don't want to put something on my calendar that constrains me if I don't have to. If it's really important to me, like doing a workshop, I'll put that on my calendar. But even with interviews and things like that, I'd rather do it within the next week or two or not have it on my schedule at all. So I don't like having a lot of appointments and things like that, because I like having the freedom to be able to travel spontaneously. That's one important thing for me. And if I want to be able to take spontaneous trips, I need to have a schedule where it's like the next 2 weeks are blank, or, you know, even 30 days or so blank. Or if there's an appointment, it's really an optional thing and I can reschedule it really easily. If you have a business and you create a business, think carefully about what type of business you're creating. Will it tie you to a certain location? Will it require you to deal with certain types of people? in, I think it was the second video in the series, the one on, whichever one was on life purpose, I talked a lot about the social consequences of your decisions, and thinking of life purpose in terms of the people you get to interact with, not as much the mission. And here I want to take that in different directions. When I first started my computer games business, I at one point got an office, and then I was tied to that office. I would commute from my apartment to the office, and I realized that I was just, you know, kind of tying myself to a physical location and didn't really like that as much. These days, I wouldn't want to do that so much unless I really thought deeply and carefully about the lifestyle consequences and I was willing to accept that. One of the reasons I got into blogging is that I liked the lifestyle freedom aspect of it. I liked that I could write anywhere. I could work at a coffee shop. I could, you know, work from home if I want. I could run my business still to this day from a laptop and a cell phone if I so desire. This video right now, I'm just filming it on my cell phone. You don't need anything too complicated to do that. I don't have to put a lot of extra burdens on my plate to maintain my lifestyle. One of the reasons I added speaking, including doing workshops later on, but getting into speaking, is that I realized if I went the blogger route, I would end up probably spending a lot of time on my computer. And that I felt would be a bit unbalanced. It would mean being very introverted, writing articles all the time. And I wanted something else to create a richer lifestyle for me in a more balanced way. And so what you may not realize is I actually started getting into speaking months before I started blogging. In April 2004, I joined Toastmasters, and it wasn't for 6 months later, in October 2004, I started blogging. So as I was thinking about this career transition, I was already beginning to think of how to balance the lifestyle issues there. So I wanted a combination of writing and speaking, because speaking is the social side. It would get me around people. Joining Toastmasters, I was interacting with people all the time and working on my social skills and having, you know, doing, I did speech contests, I did comedy improv, I joined the National Speakers Association, the Las Vegas chapter of it, and was a member of that for a while. And that, I really liked how the speaking side enriched my lifestyle in a way that blogging didn't. Speaking gave me invitations to travel. I would get invitations to speak in other cities or in Europe. Five of the six times I've been to Europe were because of speaking invitations there. And that has enriched my lifestyle, I would say, probably more than blogging. The blogging was better for the income, but I think the speaking has been better for my lifestyle overall. If I only had done the blogging, I think my lifestyle would have been a lot more limited. I wouldn't have traveled as much. I wouldn't have met as many really cool and interesting people. It definitely would have been a limiting lifestyle, I think, to just do blogging. And if I just did speaking, I think I would have missed more of the introverted side, the chance to just sit at my computer and think deeply about a topic and write about it in quiet and peace. I really like that too. Writing for me is very pleasurable. It's like a meditation. So I like having the balance of those two. There's a friend of mine who works at Microsoft, and he loves the mental stimulation of being able to hang out with brilliant people all day long. He says, every day I get to go to work with millionaires, and they keep showing up for work because they love the work they do. And that's his passion. But he also understands that does constrain his lifestyle in some ways. He can't necessarily leave that location and go travel or move to another city. He has some degree of freedom, but he's accepting those constraints in order to get access to all the benefits. Another thing I enjoy doing is connecting with entrepreneurs, because even with blogging and speaking, that can be a bit limiting socially. And I find that getting the right balance is really key to having a happy lifestyle. So I also balance that with networking with lots of entrepreneurs, going to conferences, joining a coaching club, things like that. Wherever entrepreneurs hang out, I love connecting with those types of people, especially entrepreneurs who want to make a difference in the world. You know, they're more heart-centered. They're not just all about the money. I'm really turned off by the people who are just all about the money. They don't really care about helping people. They just want to get rich. or they're willing to scam people, that sort of thing. I just steer clear of those people completely. The people who are driven by wanting to make a contribution, they want to express themselves into the world, make a difference, help people, create more growth experiences, those are wonderful, amazing people to hang out with. And I'm really happy that my life is rich in those types of connections and relationships. The main thing I want to share in this video, and I'm going to keep this one a little shorter than some of the others, mainly because I don't have the greatest energy today. The main thing I want to share is that the mistake people make is that they pick their career path first, or their work, and then they try to fit their lifestyle around that. So they take a job or they start a business, and then whatever's left while they're not working in that job or business, that becomes their lifestyle. Their lifestyle is something they see as a personal pursuit in their spare time. It's what they do in their weekends and evenings and holidays and whatever vacation time they scrape out. And I really think that's a very limiting mindset, because my experience is, and the experiences I've heard from many other people, suggests that it's much better, and you'll probably have a much happier lifestyle and probably a more fulfilling career as well if you flip that upside down. And instead of thinking career and work first, figuring that out first, instead think carefully about the type of lifestyle you want to create. What would you like to do? What would you like to experience? I would say the two most important factors in thinking about lifestyle are relationships, or people. What people do you want to connect with? What types of relationships do you want to have? What types of connections and friendships do you want to have in your life? Who do you want to have in your life? What type of person do you want your life to be rich in? And experiences, learning, skill building, growth experiences, adventures, having fun, being playful, traveling, taking vacations, whatever it is, doing experiments like I do, exploring personal growth. You know, those two things, the relationships, the connections, and the experiences, those I think are the two key factors in creating a really cool and rich and enjoyable and fulfilling lifestyle. If you get those two figured out first, if you can at least, you don't have to put all that in place, but think about what you want there. If you can get pretty clear about that and just dream, you know, think about what would be the most amazing people you'd want to connect with, who are they, what are they like, and what would be the types of experiences you want to have. Just brainstorm lists of both of those. And that'll help you start getting clearer about what type of career would support that. So if you want a life that's rich in travel, and you want to travel for several months every year, then it makes no sense to take a job that's going to fix you to one location, except maybe as a temporary measure while you're getting things going. It makes a lot more sense to pick a career path that will give you and enhance and fit into those lifestyle desires. If you choose a type of business where it's going to bring in the types of relationships and the types of connections with people that you want to have, that's a good choice. That's an intelligent choice. You can really be smarter about this, I think, by picking a career and picking a business path, a work path that will enhance and help and support your relationship desires and your experiential desires. And I've certainly had that with speaking and blogging, because I like having lots of growth experiences. I like having a lot of lifestyle freedom. These options give me social benefits. They give me a lot of freedom. They give me the ability to express myself creatively, to contribute to the world. So many beautiful things there. But this decision in large part stemmed from figuring out what kind of lifestyle I wanted to have first, and then backtracking from that and thinking, okay, now what kind of career or business would support that? And it's not an easy decision to make, because you'll probably have many different options you could pursue. And you may fail in the beginning. I certainly did. You know, I made a lot of mistakes along the way. That's perfectly okay. It's totally okay to fail. It's totally okay to stumble. Don't beat yourself up about that. Here's the good news. What I've seen, and I've seen lots of people tell me their stories about this path, because I've been writing about it for more than a decade. So I have the benefit of being able to see who's earnestly pursued this path and who hasn't. And the people I see that have pursued this path, many of them had stumbles along the way. They've slept in a park because they ran out of money while they were traveling. They started a business and realized there was no market for it and it flopped. They wrote an ebook and nobody bought it. I've seen that kind of thing over and over and over again. But you know what? They just kept going. They learned from their mistakes. They often learned a lot by connecting with other people who are already succeeding on that path and figuring out what are the strategies that work and what are the strategies that don't work. They course corrected. And eventually they figured it out. And I get emails from these people every week now telling me how great it is. And I'm thinking, yes, it is great, isn't it? It is great to have a lifestyle that's what you want and a career that supports it. And it's beautiful. It's beautiful when those all connect. But the key is not to think about this as some isolated block. So it's not like, here's your career and here's your lifestyle. The whole thing is one. You really have to think of this with a oneness mindset. Your career is part of your lifestyle. The work you do, it's a big part of your lifestyle. If you are trying to do work you hate or just don't like that much or it's not fulfilling, thinking that that's going to be the path to the better lifestyle somehow, that's totally erroneous thinking. I pretty much never see people succeed with that mindset. It's just completely the wrong mindset, because what happens is they go a year forward and they're still thinking the same way. 5 years later, they're still thinking the same way. 10 years later, they're still thinking the same way. They're just trapping themselves. They're just digging themselves a deeper hole. And the more you follow down that path, the worse it gets usually, because you start getting older and the regrets begin piling up and you start thinking about all the experiences you're not having, all the memories you're not creating. And at some point, sometimes those people snap. you have like an equivalent of a midlife crisis, something along those lines, and you say, okay, time for a different direction. I'd say it's much easier if you can get this when you're younger, if you can figure this out when you're younger and not fall into that trap of trying to think of like, here's my career and here's my life. They're both connected, they're both one. It really is something to work out and figure out holistically. And you have to accept the truth that if your work is not feeling like it's beautifully supportive of your lifestyle desires, you've got to exit it. It's time to end it. The people I see who make the fastest progress are often the ones who will just accept a lot of downgrading in their current lifestyles to get themselves free. They will move to a cheaper place. They will sleep on a friend's couch for months if they have to find a way to make this work. They will not keep going to work the same day at a job they don't like if they know it's a dead end. If it's a dead end, it's a dead end right now. It's not that it's going to get any better. It's not that it's somehow going to dig you out of the pit. It's just going to sink you in deeper, especially if you start getting promotions, just getting more into the quagmire of that path that doesn't have a heart. As Carlos Castaneda said, when a man follows a path without a heart, or something like, I think he said, a man doesn't realize he's following a path without a heart until the path is ready to kill him. And I think it's very true. When you're on that path with a heart, you know it though. You really feel it in your being. You feel how beautiful life is, just how amazingly congruent everything is, how all the pieces support each other, your relationships bring you new business opportunities or career opportunities. Those career opportunities feed into new income streams, which support your lifestyle desires, give you more freedom. It's a beautiful package. But it starts with developing clarity about what you want in terms of your relationships and what you want in terms of your experiences. And if you're not clear about that, go for exploration. On both. Go for exploration with the types, meeting different types of people, find out what kinds of people you really like connecting with, and go for exploration on the experiential side as well. And eventually you'll figure that out. That's been a big part of my path, is just giving myself a business model that gives me lots of freedom so I can explore like crazy, so I can meet all different kinds of people, so I can have all different kinds of experiences, including some that are challenging, like doing this water fast right now. I don't always know if I like these experiences, but I want to have the freedom to do lots of different things for decades to come, if I can. So I hope this gives you some insight into how to create work-life balance. You don't keep those separate, you combine them. You create a synergistic combination of work and life. They're meant to work together. I'll see you tomorrow.